If you're an individual with a disability or a person of color, you'll have to search a little harder to find someone who looks like you in the legal profession. Law happens to be one of the least diverse professions in our country. Some argue not enough is being done to change this problem because there's a lack of consensus that this is an issue to begin with. Well, locally, steps are being made to help foster a more diverse legal system. The Rochester Diversity Clerkship is an effort to do just that. And joining me to talk more about why diversity matters in law is Attorney Dwayne Bosco, chair of the Rochester Diversity Clerkship Program and immediate past president of the Rochester Black Bar Association. We're also joined by law student Deja Johnson. She is a current clerk in the program with Eastman Kodak. And welcome to both of you. I appreciate you being here.
Well, thank you for having us.
Thank you. So to begin, how problematic is it that there is an underrepresentation of legal professionals of color? I'll give that to you, Dwayne.
It's a severe problem. If you look at all of the legal professions, all of the professions across the diaspora, the law representation is the least of all of them. Doctors, engineers, or what have you. And it's important to have adequate representation in the law because the law is where everything starts. Everything from corporations, mergers, to those that make the law, judges, things of that nature, they draw on that pool of attorneys. So that's why it's important to have proper representation in the community.
And we hear that law is one of the least diverse professions, but do we actually know why that's the case? Is it a matter of a lack of interest in this particular field, or is it a matter of hiring practices from firms and corporations, a little bit of both?
Well, I would say that it's more regarding the hiring practices. For instance, there's still a problem with women in the law as far as getting promotions, even though women make up more than 50% of the law students currently in law school right now. So it's a change of atmosphere, it's a change of hiring practices, and also not also hiring, but also retention. So that's what this program aims to take a shot at.
Well, Deja, you are attending Syracuse Law. You're from Hagerstown, Maryland. So tell me a little bit about what inspired you to pursue the legal field. Was there a story, a person, a situation, something that kind of launched you into this field?
I would say it's my natural drive to be anywhere that's competitive. Law school is notoriously known for being competitive. At Syracuse, we're very collegiate environment. We're very nice to one another. But, you know, in the past, we've all heard the law school stories about being cold called. I wouldn't say it was necessarily a person, just that my drive for competition and for knowing more. So that's probably what.
Well, the Rochester Legal Diversity Clerkship Program, it's co-sponsored by the Monroe County Bar Association,
yes,
the Rochester Black Bar Association, and the Greater Rochester Association for Women Attorneys. You started to mention this just a little,
yes,
bit before I talk with Deja. What is its objective?
Its objective is to diversify the legal community here in the Rochester area. We're going into our 14th year right now. It was the brainchild of Mike Wolford. He brought it to the Bar Association. We're in full support of it. The Black Bar Association, RBBA, and also GRAWA lent their support to the program. And through the years, we've had over 150 clerks come through the program. Many of those have stayed and started their legal careers here, I being one of
That's
them.
That's right. I read about this. Because you weren't from the Rochester area.
No.
Okay. That's the question is, I mean, how difficult is it to, I mean, you've got this great group of people like Deja, how likely is it that they will either start off their profession or at some point in their tenure return to Rochester to practice?
Well, the program itself has a success rate of about 22% to 24% return rate of the clerks that go through the program to come back for their second year and eventually start here in Rochester. As far as the percentage can be even higher when you include those that went through the program, didn't start their careers here, but came back to Rochester. The purpose of the program is to make sure that Rochester is being exposed to upcoming talented professionals in the legal community so that if they don't start right after their completion of law school here, they still have a home, they have connections, and they've already made an impression on the legal community here.
Deja, how valuable is a program like this?
Oh, it's extremely valuable.
Talk to me about why and what you're doing, what you're learning, what the day in the life of, you know, a day in the life is for you, if I can say that correctly. Mm-hmm. What, I mean, talk a little bit about that.
Well, first, I just want to speak very highly of the program. I mean, Dwayne came to Syracuse, and he advertised the program to myself, and there's another Syracuse University law student that's doing it as well, and he's also having a great time. It's very important because on a lot of this diversifying the legal profession starts in the classroom, and it starts with getting people to law school, and that's getting people to undergraduate universities that are of a minority, that are a marginalized part of the community. So it's very important. A day in my life, pretty much the same thing I do in law school, just work really hard. just work really hard. When you're in the field, you usually like the field, so you like the work that you're doing, you don't mind doing it. So it's nice, you get to network and meet great people like Dwayne. So you have a lot of opportunities that just weren't present to you before law school, and they certainly weren't present before this program. So again, I do speak very highly of it wherever I go.
When you look around your classroom, mm-hmm. In law school, do you see people who look like you, or would you say that you're a rarity?
A rarity. Oh yeah, definitely a rarity. I see people that look like me that might not think like me, but then I see people that think like me that might not look like me. So I try not to be too judgmental. Well, I try not to be judgmental at all. But there is an extreme lack of diversity in the classroom and the legal profession in general, and a lot of professional careers. And I think that's something that we definitely have to work on.
So you mentioned, Dwayne, you said we have this low number of legal professionals of a variety of different cultures and races because of hiring practices. But what does it take to kind of meet that need that Deja is mentioning in terms of making this a field where people feel like, A, they're needed, that we need that representation, right, and they want to pursue it?
Well, I guess it starts with creating a pipeline. And this is, even though we're going into our 14th year of doing the clerkship program, 2 years ago, with the help of Kevin McDonald, who was at RIT, has since moved on to the Missouri Regents, we created a retention and inclusion offset of this particular program that runs in conjunction with this, where it concentrates on creating a pipeline, going into the high schools, letting them know what an attorney of color looks like, letting them know that it is achievable, partnering with other undergraduate programs that have a Discover Law program such as UB does, so that we can try to create that type of pipeline from high school through undergraduate and then on into law school. We've received tremendous buy-in from our other employers in the program into this initiative. We help sponsor continuing legal education courses for attorneys to let them know the importance of creating such a pipeline.
Yeah. Let me ask you real quick. You mentioned that in terms of buy-in from other firms and corporations, yes, have since participating in this program, do you know, have any openly shared whether or not they've strengthened their diversity initiatives or they've changed their hiring practices in any way?
Yes. Now, obviously, the hiring practices are kept behind closed doors. We're not privy to everything. But through some connections and some personal conversations, I can attest to the fact that the program has made a difference. We've had buy-ins from large firms such as Nixon Peabody, Woods Oviatt, Harris Beach, who are continually hiring our clerks, to corporate sponsors, Kodak, Xerox, Wegmans supports some of the events of the program. And I know I'm leaving a ton of other employers out. I don't mean to, believe me. Underberg and Kessler. It goes on and on.
Yeah.
But more importantly, what's going on is that through the program, even if they started with the program initially, what I've seen is that there's other larger firms that have created their own diversity clerkship program that really resembles our program. So now, even if they're not participating, now they're having to do their own outreach.
That's great. Deja, I want to ask you, why, in terms of, for people watching this right now, and they may be thinking, well, how does diversity in the legal profession impact me? What would you say to them? Why should the community care?
Well, these are people that come from your community. So we understand the struggles, and we understand a lot of the stuff that goes on behind closed doors and a lot of the feelings that just never leave somebody's living room. So being able to have individuals and being able to talk and have platforms where you're able to voice your concerns and you're able to to just understand about what's going on, it makes it so much easier. So I would just say to everyone, if you want to go to law school, go to law school.
All right, we have to close for now. We are out of time, but I want to thank you both for joining me today and for sharing your perspectives on this topic. To learn more about the Rochester Legal Diversity Clerkship, go to mcba.org.